And then we start our meeting.
Good morning,
everyone. Good morning.
We have with us a Sanskrit scholar and my dear friend, Dr. Anuradha Choudhary, who is teaching at the IIT Kharagpur. She has done her PhD in the area of mantra. She is from basically her area of work is been from the faculty of Sanskrit. And her specialization has been in that name. Plus, she has also studied Sri Aurobindo's philosophy in great detail. Her passion has been to spread the dimensions of Indian culture, philosophy, to different parts of the world. So, she's been conducting workshops in Indian psychology and trying to reflect on the realm of spirituality. So, she is trying to do several experiments in different areas of Indian philosophy. Plus, she also is having a rich dimension of language. She knows more than 5 languages. Basically, from a language realm, that is Sanskrit, and also Indian and languages, and philosophy, and whatever she is trying to do. There is a kind of an exploration which she is engaged with, and today she will like. Reflect on that engagement of mind and whatever she has been able to study. So she will share something, and I'm sure this experience will be wonderful.
You know, she is a person who is extremely fluent in Sanskrit, French, and Italian.
These are the 5 languages, English, Hindi, Marathi.
That is why Priya didn't mention it, so I said she speaks well in Sanskrit, in French, and also Italian. And then the rest of the Indian languages. Bangla, and Hindi, and Kannada, and Marathi, and... Yeah.
So, namaste. And I'd like to start by thanking Dr. Joshi and Dr. Vaidya for giving me this opportunity of sharing a few thoughts on leadership, especially from this angle of Swaraat to Samraat, the path of the leader. And what I thought of doing is, I was thinking of doing this in a rather informal manner, not with some great presentation and all. But one thing that I have found very helpful in my interaction with people from different cultures on certain fundamental aspects of the yoga tradition, because I also work with yoga psychology. So one of the things that I have found quite valuable is to start, or rather is to question some of the fundamentals of a lot of concepts that we are already familiar with. Because I believe that once we are sure that we are using words in the same way, because when we use a particular word, they can actually have different shades of understanding in different people's minds. And then when I add to that with more words, sometimes it can lead to misunderstanding of things rather than a greater clarification. So what we'll try and do is first to establish some fundamental baselines about what we mean when we say certain things. And then taking that, we'll go forward and see how to, you know, build on that. But if I could just ask you briefly to just maybe introduce yourself very quickly so that I just get an idea of the background from which you're coming in order to make it more related to what you are actually involved in your regular life. So if you could just quickly tell me your name and just what's your background a little bit. Start.
My name is Subhash Kumar. I'm from the Institute of Transportation of Bali. My name is Prashant Dayar. I head the series for Anuradha.
My name is Venkatesh, I spoke for sales in telecom for work.
My name is Ganesh Rahul, and student leader of the National Student Union of India.
Kiran Mishra, and I'm a fresher. Siddhi Savitri, and I'm a fresher. I've done my graduation in years.
My name is Meena Lama. I have my business, that's event management company, as well as I'm a trainer also.
Vaibhav Sadha, my business is into licensing. I get fed up work done from the government officials.
Your name?
Vaibhav.
I'm Sheikh Farhan. I'm also fresher, but I have completed my graduation in political science and
My name is Ambarish, but my domain is sales and marketing. I work for a company in international business.
I'm Chetan Gandhi. I'm a practicing company secretary and legal consultant, and I am in the region of Spanish law and sales.
I'm Rajesh Pendekar. I'm into pharma supply chain consulting.
Josh Patel. I'm a doctor engineer in Capsule.
I'm a
psychology
and career psychometry is
and a
student
of
yoga.
I'm
working
in IT operations.
Hello,
sir. I am
here from IT. Hi, my name is Samraat. I'm working with RBS and I'm a
baker. Hi, I'm Swaraat. I head the technology support for Wi-Fi. My name is Anuradha Choudhary. I work in area of finance, planning and
My name is Pranav. I've been in banking for around 8 years. Now planning to do something in our consulting business.
My name is Anu. Last year I completed my education. I'm working in the field.
So I'm very humbled to be in your midst because you all you're already coming from a lot of, most of you here are coming from a lot of experience already and you're already in various kinds of leadership positions. So like I said, we'll just find a common ground, revisit certain fundamentals of who a leader is, what does it mean to lead, etc. Okay, so if I can just hear some things from you or maybe if you just like write down just these basic questions you answer. So who exactly is a leader? That's one. Then the second is, what is the importance of a leader? Right. Someone else?
leads in a direction.
Gives a direction. More or less. Huh? Anybody has something very different to say from any of this that you feel is important? Yeah? Sort of covers it. And what's the importance therefore of a leader?
To lead the group of people on a right direction to achieve the final ultimate goal.
Okay. To lead people in it practically summarizes in the right direction. Can you all see what I'm writing?
Yes.
Right direction?
To achieve the final or ultimate goal or destiny.
Okay. So, if we can you see this? It's down there.
Yes.
Okay. So now there are some very important words that have emerged in this definition of a leader, right? So one is that lead. We've seen that leader is one who leads. You're familiar with the Sanskrit word for leader?
Netrutva.
Neta. Yeah, so it comes from the Sanskrit root me, which means to lead, to take along. So the moment you talk about take along, there are a few questions that emerge, like who could you follow as a leader? Now put yourself as a follower. Who would you follow as a leader? Who would you choose as a leader to follow? What would you look for in a leader that would encourage you to follow such a person? What are the qualities?
Who would impress us?
Positive thinker.
Truthfulness.
Thinking.
Positive thinking. I'll just do some abbreviations.
Yeah.
Man with words.
Man of value.
Walk the talk.
Walk the talk, yes. Right.
Walkie talkie. Walk talk. Alright. Value. A value based.
A good human being.
Good human being.
Good
human
being.
Good human being.
Charismatic.
Good human. But just one thing, see, when you're saying good human.
It is a general statement.
Yeah, it is.
What is a good human? Right.
Everybody.
So, good human. So, when we try to arrive at a definition of a word, we really need to also make sure that the definition doesn't overlap everything else and fulfills our purpose. That is important, right? So a good human being is a little too generous. I mean, it's a little too vast as a definition because you don't follow every good human being.
There are very few good human beings.
Oh no.
Actually.
It is. No, no.
Don't come across, actually speaking, you don't come across human beings.
There is no definition.
A good human being, though, is very rare.
You are making my task very hard because now we have to then go and define who is a good human being. No, it's not unrelated. The word good human is not unrelated to the discussion we will have on the concept of the Swaraat. Huh? And of course, it's the key thing because if you know for sure that somebody, okay, let me take it one step back from there. What are the questions, if somebody says, follow me, what are the basic questions that you will ask?
Why?
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 What is the purpose?
That's why.
Where you will lead me?
Where
you will lead me?
Yes. What will be the benefit?
So first of all, that's why I said this definition was brilliant because the leader means someone is following. Okay, if somebody is following, then you have to say, where are you taking me? So there
what
is a notion
for
of,
me?
There is a notion of the right direction. So there is a right direction which has to connect with what's in it
what's
for
it
me.
For,
that you can have good human beings who are going in their own direction, but if it doesn't fulfill the direction I'm intending to go, I will not follow that person. So it's not just enough that a person is showing me a direction. It has to also match with the direction that I want to go, right? So, a few things are emerging just out of that, if you can see it. Like I said, we go very, very slowly. Huh? So, if somebody is saying I want to go there, first and if the leader wants to go there, it means that that direction is important. It could be for the company, it could be for whatever. But it is accepted as an important direction to follow. Correct. Now if it is an important direction to follow and I'm going alone, then I'm hardly a leader. I have to be able to, one is find out who all want to go in that direction. So another important trait that comes out of a leader is identifying. But for that, how would you as a leader know who is interested in this group? Because you have a group when you are trying to lead, let's say in a company or anywhere, you'll get a mixed bag of people.
Yeah. Common interest. Common interest.
So the first and foremost, you have to also have a
vision.
The vision is to, it can be the institutional vision. So institution, yeah. I mean the organizational vision. So somebody's already set up a vision. First and foremost, that vision has to be valid and important for all those who have signed up for this project.
Yeah.
Otherwise people will not sign up, and even if they follow, it will be half-hearted. So first and foremost, that vision that one has focused on has to have sufficient implication and value, deeper value, for all those who are expected to follow. Yes.
It should, I think, epitomize the aspirations of people.
Usually it happens the other way, you know, that an institute sort of sets its goals and then people follow it. Right.
And that happens in typically a corporate or an academic institution.
Acha.
Political leadership, a political leader needs to understand the aspirations of people and then take people to those aspirations.
Is that how you would see it? We can have a double position on this. In a political leadership, what you are saying is that you have to listen to the people and then take them there. But if you know, if one knows that, again, especially in a country like ours where diversity is our salient feature, you have diversity on every walk, every step that you take, you have a diverse opinion, you have a diversity. So if one had to take all that into consideration,
not possible.
It would take forever.
Yeah, absolutely.
It would take forever to arrive at any kind of consensus. So the goal of the leader in that first place is to be able to identify already what is the largest common good.
Yeah.
So the largest common good, yes.
And also influencing the larger mass to a particular goal. Because the leader attempts to influence the mass.
So that is what we were saying. So one was that the leader sees the goal, then he has this other group of people whom he has to carry along. So that's the quality that we talked about here. He has followers, but he has to drive objectives.
He's an influencer.
Yeah, right? Then he has to, now you have a mixed bag of people who have already signed up for the project. So the value of good leadership lies in the ability of this leader to inspire and convince and motivate this other group of people to follow. Okay, now where I will just briefly bring out one important word again from the Sanskrit, in Sanskrit, which is it highlights one quality of a leader. Because now I have a goal there and I have to try and communicate it to the followers. So communication is key, because if you can't translate the objective effectively enough, you are not going to be able to carry them along with you. Right? So communication is key. Now what kind of communication should a leader have? Maybe I'll just open this up quickly and I'll take it on. What are the qualities of communication that a leader needs to have to convince a group to follow along?
To connect to people's hearts,
absolutely. So first and foremost, it's a major step, it's not just a reason. It's not enough to say, you know, that's the best thing to do and you need to go there and all.
It's the V language.
Yes, there is the whole emotion, emotive, you have to touch a deeper core of the individual to convince them to follow that, right? Okay, so there is this word in Sanskrit which is the word apatti. Apatti. You know the word apatti?
Empathy.
What does apatti mean in Marathi? Or
problem? Disaster.
Disaster.
Problem.
Really means disaster. Problem, disaster, anything else?
Samraat.
संकट कोई संकट बोला है हाँ हाँ और एक और है यू कैन ऑल इट कैन ऑल्सो मीन ऑब्जेक्शन इन डिफरेंट लैंग्वेज ऑब्जेक्शन ओके नाउ लेट्स एग्जामिन दिस वर्ड बिकॉज व्हेन आई डिस्कवर्ड इट वाज लाइक अ वाव मोमेंट फॉर मी ऑल राइट सो आई शेयर इट विद यू नाउ इफ आई एम अ लाइक इफ यू टेक द मीनिंग ऑफ आपत्ति एज ऑब्जेक्शन सो इफ आई एम द स्पीकर एंड आई एम ट्राइंग टू कन्विंस यू ऑफ अ पॉइंट एंड वन ऑफ यू रेजेस योर हैंड एंड सेज बट मैम आई डोंट अग्री नाउ व्हाट वुड बी माय फर्स्ट रिएक्शन नॉर्मली Would you mean? Exactly. Uh-huh. No, what do you mean? Excuse me. No, I'm taking all this effort. So the first reaction, you look at that person as a problem to what you're trying to communicate in this room. So we can see how the word apathy can mean a problem and its extended meaning. All right. Now, if you go to the root of the word apathy, it comes from the root pat, which means to fall. A means towards you. So, apathy is something that falls upon you. Still, it's not very clear. Where's the connection? When you look at this word in a philosophical context, so like Shankaracharya in his commentaries, philosophical commentaries, uses the word apathy as a realization. That fits the word perfectly because what is a realization? When something falls upon you. So the idea has come to you like, okay, now when you are, now if I'm as a speaker, I'm trying to convince you of something and one of you says, but I did not get it. Normally if I am an egoistic speaker, I will regard your objection, I will regard your intervention as an objection and as a problem because I'm convinced that I'm a very effective speaker. Correct. Huh. And the fact that you can't get it means something is wrong with you. But if you look at the word from its root point of view, that actually it means that it is a realization, and I know that, then what I would understand is that that person has had a realization that my communication is not complete. As a communicator, what is important? That what I am presenting is what you should understand. Clear? Now, if you are saying but, it means that you have not understood what I am trying to say. And you have had a realization that there is a gap in what I am trying to present. So if I understand this basic thing and I am a good speaker, then I will welcome your objections. Because for me, what is important at the end of the day is to make myself understood to each one of you. Because if you can understand, it will be easy to follow. Otherwise, you are doing something which is not connecting with you. You are zabardasti coming along. And that will have its own corollary problems. Okay? So for you to follow along, I have to make sure that you are capturing what I am saying the way I intended to be said, but in your language. So one very important shift that one does as a speaker, if you understand what apathy actually signifies, is to shift from an egoistic, imposing speaker onto a communicator who's ready to listen. Because the more you are listening to everybody, the more you know, first and foremost, where is it everybody wants to go. Since I have my goal clear, it would then become easier for me to help everybody to follow the road I want to follow. So, in a sense, the leader at that case becomes a follower. Huh? We are not just there. Yes.
What if the masses, as you say, listen? Then listening might take you to a different direction altogether than where I want to go. Because it might be different because the goal which that particular leader or the organization. And if it's listening to what the larger audience is saying and interpreting and moving in that direction, it might just lose track and go into a completely different direction. And because the larger goal might be different, or probably the larger consensus might be different from what a smaller or an individual goal might be.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a very brilliant point. Now, the thing there, that's the difference between a good leader and somebody who's just in a leadership position. A good leader, first and foremost, those who are raising the objections or who are saying it, they have signed up for a project. They have taken your basic parameters into consideration and only then signed up for it. Otherwise, they would not be part of this team. They would have gone and joined some other team. So obviously, there is something of the objectives that has resonated with the person's wishes. Okay, then there might be a gap in how that person is understanding those objectives and interpreting them. Now, a good leader is one who's got a very clear sight of where one has to go. But the good leader also, while listening to everybody, is able to convince them that there is something else that needs to be followed in order to reach there together. Because a good leader would also be able to tell somebody who's completely disillusioned that, sorry, this is not your cup of tea. It is not that just because somebody has signed up, it is what will be the larger interest of that individual. Get that? So a good leader has to be able to even understand where that person basically wants to go. So when we talk of a good leader, it is not just one who has followers, but who has followers who are willing and enthusiastic to go that same way. Okay? Huh? So just one thing of understanding this word apathy, and if you can use it effectively in your practice, is that you then start listening to what is it. So when you're presenting a subject, it can be the objectives, it can be anything. At the same time, there is this openness to listen to what is the response that I'm getting, so that I can relate better. I can relate better to make those people turn around and come that way. Is that making sense to you?
At times it might not match. Is that you're just trying to put two things which are not.
Okay.
It might happen. I'm not saying it will not happen every time.
Okay.
But these are two possible. One.
Absolutely.
It might just be a straight way, or sometimes it might be like, they're just not matching right with it together.
Absolutely. So, like I said, one option is that you as a leader recognize the needs of that person and tell him that you're in the wrong project. To be able to have the confidence to tell, but why will that person listen to you? So, what is another very, very important quality that a leader needs to have from the team?
You should know the interest.
Sorry.
The common interest you should be having.
Like common interest, but the other most important thing is the trust factor.
Yeah.
Alright. Now, in order to build up trust, I'll come to this whole notion of the Swaraat. When I tell you about Swaraat, what do you understand? What do you understand by these two words, Swaraat and Samraat?
Samraat is a king.
Alright, yes.
King emperor.
King of oneself. So the self-ruler and the world ruler. Huh? And what I have called this particular presentation is from Swaraat to Samraat. Alright. So when we talk of swa in Sanskrit is the self, oneself. Rat is the root for Raja. Right? That's the root cause. So the self-ruler is one who can lead the other, who can become a world ruler. And in our regular practice on management and all that, the emphasis is normally on trying to manage everybody. There is very little attention on the value and importance of managing oneself. Just like you can imagine, if you have a leader who is constantly throwing tantrums and not doing any, you know, how enthusiastically would you follow someone like that?
No.
Secondly, when we talked about direction, so we talked of where the leader is going, who would you follow? When you know that somebody is going, where one is going, why one is going, and how one is going there. These are the important things. If you trust that that person knows all these things clearly, that is when you are going to put yourself in that position to follow. Because the train is on. The gaadi chalegi. You will only get on a gaadi that you think will reach you safely to the destination. Nobody is going to get into a gaadi which is derailed. You know, which has a driver which is not in control. So in order to get into a, as a follower, in order to get into a position of a follower, first and foremost you would require is to be able to trust the, I would say sanity, but trust the knowledge and the wisdom of the one who's at the helm of affairs. Fine. Now, since you've signed up for the leadership project, leadership program, everybody here is an aspiring leader, and it's already a leader in your own way. Right. But when one recognizes that the importance is to have, as a follower, you would trust how much the person knows where he is going, then you would be even more ready to get into it. Similarly, since each of you is in the position of the driver right now, people will only follow when you are convinced, when they are convinced that you know where you are going. So understanding of oneself becomes key in being able to even convince anybody else to come along. If the perception of the person that this person is completely scattered, nobody is going to come. So the first focus of leadership in that context becomes focusing on oneself and understanding where is it that I am headed. Alright. So because we have direction involved, we have right direction involved, we have the final goal, all these objectives are involved. It also becomes important for the individual to have a clear vision, be a proper visionary. Now, what is it that helps an individual or when? Okay, now let me put it in the other way. If you had to analyze yourselves, now maybe I'll give you 5 minutes to just think of yourself and maybe just write down about yourself as a visionary. How would you look at yourself as a visionary? Is my question clear? Is it clear? No, it's not so clear, na? That how much do you consider yourself to be a visionary? How clear is your vision about things? Because if you're aspiring leaders, or if you are already in leadership positions, the clarity of your vision is key. Like we said, vision leads to trust, leads to convincing your followers. So what is the degree of clarity in your vision of things as you? So one is you, your vision of objectives, and the second is your own clarity in yourself. How connected are you in your own being? Being able to convince a group to follow it. So maybe just take 2-3 minutes or 5 minutes to just give this a thought. How aligned are you in yourself about where you're headed, why you would want anyone to follow you? Is it clear enough?
So this relates to our personal experiences, that what decision we have taken on the basis of what purpose, what we wanted to achieve.
Exactly.
And that's the vision.
Exactly.
The goal is our vision. And then what I have been doing to achieve my goals.
Exactly, but maybe not even so elaborate in that sense. You need to, right now there's no time to go into it in depth, because these are all, since the work is about self-rule, self-rule is a lifetime project. Self-rule. So right now I'm just giving you about 3 to 5 minutes to conclude on that. But what I'd like you to do is just to close your eyes and just try and understand for yourself that how clear is your own vision about yourself, where you would like to take people with you. What is your own degree of clarity about yourself? So just take about 5 minutes to get clarity on that. How aligned are you in your thoughts, words, actions, feelings? for 5 minutes or so.
No, the vision that you're asking us to set must not be time bound.
It has to be.
Otherwise, it is like eternal. Vision or time
can be eternal.
I would say it's more your life goal. No, there has to be clarity of where would you, okay, maybe to help you, maybe another one of my favorite questions in this context is, if let's say the supreme power descended in front of you and said you have a blank check, right? Anything you want of where you want to go in life. Because life is a time-bound thing also. Yeah. But whatever point it is, I would at least have liked to reach there. This is what I would really like to have done. Then I would feel fulfilled. Because at the end of the day, even if you are a leader, you're not doing it really for everybody else. Each one is finally on their own personal fulfillment track.
Yes.
Yes.
In the process, others can also get fulfilled. But at the end of the day, the reality is that we are pretty much on very individual journeys.
Yes.
Right? People will come along and people will not come along. They'll come along for a certain distance. Right? But ultimately, at the end of the day, the only one that we would ever be really answerable to is oneself. Even if you're making great profit in the company, but you're not getting something out of it, at the end of the day, it will be useless for oneself. So what would really count is clarity on where is it that I'm wanting to go. Right. So I'll give you this little time, yes.
It can be a possible culmination also. Where the track changes. So
yes. I think that's what you were asking, that you know it can shift, but doesn't matter. But that's why I'm saying clarity, because if we are talking of vision, the greater the clarity of the long distance journey, the less diversions there will be on the way. You get it? The need to have clarity of the long distance vision is so that you're not going round and round and round when time is being spent. Time, energy, resources, everything is being spent.
Life is spent.
Life. Yes, non-returnable resource. Right. So there is a lot of value in understanding the long term. So it could have been that, okay, I chose to do this in life. But out of that, what was I looking for that then added on to the next big project? There will be a thread.
There's a small goals which could be time-bound,
but there is an underlying thread. Exactly. There is an underlying thread. Now the greater clarity one has about that underlying thread for oneself, the more one will walk on the highway of one's life, the less diversions there is into the byways that might end up in dead ends. So acquiring, having that greater clarity of the larger thing is key. Let's forget everybody else. The first focus of this is really the Swaraat business. Okay, how much am I aligned to my purpose of being? So, I'll give you another 2 minutes. I thought I'll make you do this exercise at the end so that there's greater clarity, but I'll give you a few more minutes. It's worth the time spent. You will not get a final answer on it. The blank check has erasable options on it also. But what I would like you to do is to just put down, if you've got a blank check, and the beauty is you can put it in any permutation and combination. Most often, circumstance makes us believe that I can only do it in this way. But in the Indian, I mean, there's a linearity of possibilities that emerges because we believe that circumstance is what determines how we choose, make our choices. It's in that context that like the fundamentals of all religious thought in a sense empower us enormously. Of all philosophies of all cultures, they empower us with the possibility that the essential creative force is inside. The same force that organizes the universe is the same force that is at the source of our being. Exactly the same force. So there is nothing that says it can only be that way. It will only be that way if that is the only thing that I can conceive of. So, like I said, I'll give you another 2 minutes. 5 minutes? 2 minutes? Just say yes.
What if there is someone who comes out and says, I have no goal. There is no particular place where I'm happy with the surrounding and the environment that I am at the moment. There is no particular reason of goal that which person is surrounding.
Absolutely. But you will see that the fact that we are all making choices, like that's another important thing to understand. And this is also, it ties in with the whole Vedic idea of the yajna. When we talk of this, the yajna that is taking place, we believe that it's a ritual. But actually there is a whole psychological dimension to it. And the psychological dimension is that whether you like it or not, we are making choices. Every second of our lives, we are making a choice. You have made a choice to come and join this. You could have been doing 10 other things. But everybody in this room has chosen to come here, though you might have had other engagements. So, we are, when the moment you are thinking of something, you have chosen a direction. We are all choosing directions the moment you are thinking. And it is an investment of resources as well. So, when somebody says, I don't have a goal, it only implies that the person has not spent time to understand that they are already making choices based on a subconscious goal. There is something that is subconsciously driving them to do what they are doing. Alright, so when we talk about Swaraat, it is really about opening our eyes to what is the whole baggage that is forming our moment-to-moment decisions. If we don't have clarity of all those different inputs that is making us say, I like this, I don't like this, I want to go there, I don't want to go there. These are choices that we are making. We might be convinced by somebody else and agree to do that, but even that is an agreement. It is a conscious step. So, the work of a leader who believes or who finds that there is someone who is unsure is to help bring clarity to that person. But again, that can only happen if that journey has been undertaken by oneself. It's only if, as a leader, we have bothered to investigate our blind spots that we could have clarity on being able to help someone else discover their blind spots. Okay? So, if you want to just like again, I go back to that point, you have a blank check, you want to just write up, you want to put in that direction. It may not be the final. But what is it you've been investigating? What is it you have been following? So just write down, even if it's just a few words, like I said, it may not be anything final, but it is worth the exercise. What is it you're looking for? Okay. Okay, those who have completed it, maybe you can also write down what are your blind spots.
What is blind spots?
Blind spot is in what is it that prevents you, your weaknesses, huh? What is it that is coming in the way of allowing you to get where you want to get? Yeah, inhibitions. What is obstructing you? What are your obstacles? Where is it? it's a long process. But if maybe some of you would like to just share some of your obstacles. Okay, because the goal is a very personal thing, where you want to head in life. But the obstacles that we encounter are very often common. Okay, so if you'd like to just share some obstacles that you encounter in your process of following your path.
Lack of knowledge. So I'll say ignorance, is that good? Okay. Apprehensions, fears, okay. Lack of consistency. Lack of consistency is again a symptom, it is not a cause.
Self-discipline.
When there is lack of consistency, it's a symptom. What would it be a symptom of? Is that clear?
Distraction.
If somebody is not consistent.
Distraction.
Discipline.
Lack of discipline, yes. If you push that even further.
Distraction.
Laziness. Laziness could be one, yes.
Attachment.
Okay, if you push that, attachments could be one. Lack of consistency.
Attachment.
Comfort zone. Coming out of
comfort. Comfort zone. Lethargy. Or I just say lazy ones. Then somebody else is something else. Discipline. No discipline.
Self-discipline.
Lack of self-discipline.
Lack of self-discipline. Oh, yeah.
Yes. Main obstacle I find is not able to control the five vices.
I knew of six of them.
Self-doubt.
Which one are you free of?
Six.
Self-doubt.
Self-doubt. Great.
He has a problem.
Bataye. Please.
That is what he is
saying. Introvert. You said introversion, no?
Introvert,
yeah. Okay, no, it's great because now the thing is that since we are again discussing ways of becoming in a leader position, understanding these and tackling them is vital, right? So, someone said attachments. What is the opposite of attachments? Also, if somebody doesn't like something, repulsion. That's it. Put it as repulsions.
Aversion.
All right. So, it's fantastic that you've come up with this because you've heard of Patanjali, right? Not our Baba Ramdev Patanjali, the original one.
Yes.
Okay, so the original Patanjali, he has this Ashtanga Yoga, no? Ashtanga Yoga that is there, the Yoga Sutras. Ma'am and all would have talked to you about it, right, in detail. So, are you familiar with the concept of the kleshas? The kleshas that, first of all, are you familiar with his definition of what is yoga? So he says yoga is the stoppage of the mental movements. So he says there are five kinds of these mental movements. So one is that you are imagining things. Now what is the problem of, if as a leader you're constantly imagining things that are not true, what would happen? You can imagine. Exactly. Because you need to be present and not be where things are not. So the first and foremost thing is to be able to see things for what they are. The value of being in the present moment, to be aware of the reality of that time, is key. Otherwise you've lost the plot. Then the second one is about imagining things for being, not imagining, looking at things for being something else. Not seeing, so if there is a rope, you will think it's a snake. For example, so if somebody is maybe telling you, no, you know, this is the reason why I cannot do something or what I don't like. Instead of listening to what that person is saying, you're imagining what that person might be implying. So, and where does that come from? Does it come from that person or does it come from you? It It is a filter in our vision. So when we're talking of vision of something, we also recognize that we have these various filters. These glaciers are nothing more but various filters that are obstructing our clarity of vision. Now the problem with that is, if you can imagine at night, if you are wearing many colored glasses and you can't see something in front, what will happen? Accident, right? So there is a great value in trying to clear up the glass of our perception. And like we said, what Patanjali said, these are the main ones. So there is ignorance, or avidya he calls it. Then there are, then he actually says that there is another important one is ego. Asmita. So if I am convinced that I am doing everything the right way, then there is no leading and then there is no following happening. There is only individual walking that is taking place. Yes.
Asmita is a bit essential.
Yes. So what you are saying is very right, because even Sri Aurobindo says this. He says, ego is the helper. No, ego was the helper. Ego is the bar. Which means that if I don't even know why I do what I do, then so anyone will tell you, go there and you will go. You will become like a footman. You will just blow with the wind. There is no question of following. So first, ego is important. That's the good kind of asmita, where you build your own individuality. Understand where one is going, why one is going. Okay. Now when that has happened, only, but then if I am convinced that that's the only way of doing things. My way is the way, other is my way or the highway. Alright. Then one is in trouble. So that's the second kind of ego which you have to, which becomes an obstacle. Okay? So ego. So ignorance. Ignorance is the biggest one. Not knowing things is one way. The second one is my way is the only way of doing it, is the bigger kind of ignorance. Huh? Where does that come from? When I'm convinced that that's the only way of doing things, where does that come from? It comes from oneself, but it comes from one's attachments, one's likes and one's dislikes. I like this, I like this, I like this, I like this. That's the way everybody has to like. I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like this. Anybody who likes it is problematic. Okay. So, and the last one is fear. My God, if somebody is doing better, they're going to take my position and what will happen to my existence? So that's the abhinivesha, your existential fears.
Alright.
Huh? Is this clear? Is this clear as far as it's going?
Yes.
So when we are talking of Swaraat, the whole process of Swaraat in very simple terms is about cleaning the lens.
Speaking.
Cleaning the lens of your vision. And that lens, I mean, it can get into a very elaborate discussion of where you're giving your senses to, because our senses are what are determining our likes and dislikes. So what are we giving our senses to? How do you control them? You know, that's the whole process of the yogic process. Now, yoga is not just about the asanas, you know, the yoga is really about this understanding of self. Now, when we talk of these other ones, that there is, because Patanjali also identifies these as the obstacles to one's progress. Yes, please.
So, Swati, is it right to say that Swaraat, as you said, is the cleaning of the lens, and that lens are these five obstacles?
Those are the colors on the lens. Those are the different filters. So, the lens is clean by itself, technically, possibly. But that lens has got these various colored filters on it. And these are all those colored filters.
And by overcoming these, you are clarifying or making your vision still stronger.
Exactly. Now, how does that fit in, let's say, in a leadership context? How do you see this? Now, let me ask, put this to you, that if you're a leader and I'm telling you that, you know, these are the lenses, I mean, these are the filters that are creating obstructions to your vision, how do you understand it? Like, if you clear it out, it will help. Can you put it in a real life situation for yourself? Because these are your filters also. So can you identify a circumstance where you say, acha, this is what was happening and this happened and this was the filter that was didn't allow me to see things for what it was. Would you like to share? I mean, it could be personal, but if you'd like to.
Yes.
sometimes I have self-doubt here, I will be able to do it or no, little doubt in mind whether okay. I will be able to complete the task.
Alright, so which one would you put of this?
A little luck, no.
Which of this would you see there? Very, very practically, see, if there is a doubt, like even whether it's introversion or whatever, these are all coming from other kind of problem areas.
The little laziness.
Laziness, so you don't want to see where?
Sorry?
Is there a lack? If you're saying that you have self-doubt. Self-doubt could emerge from what things? What are the factors that lead to self-doubt?
Maybe I will be
ignorance. So ignorance, one is ignorance of where I have to go. And second ignorance is?
What I need to do.
Efforts.
What am I capable of? So you see, again it comes down to the greater I understand that I am capable of this. If I am not capable, then no doubt. So you know I can't do it. Okay, that's very straightforward. But if there is a doubt, then what is the process out of it? So one can be that I have a self-doubt and it can lead to, oh my god, I cannot do things now. It can lead to a lack of confidence.
Yeah.
But if I just stop myself, so that lack of confidence will come from the ego, which says, oh my god, I'm not capable. I mean, I will fail. I will. So it is the image of oneself that you are getting worried about.
Yes.
Right. But now if you are free of this lens, of the ego lens, and you are in a situation where you say, I don't know what to do. If you were in the present moment, you would say, okay, what do I need to do? And what are my resources? And then you start trying to do it. You will not get into the trap of, oh my god, I'm going to become a failure now. What will happen?
What people will say.
What people will say about me. All these anxieties about images that we have built will naturally become, cleared up. Is that clear? Anything else that you would like? Basically, what I'm trying to say is that the more one has clarity about where one is, what is one's potentials, what is the filter that is coming in the way, you have to be able to step back to see what is the filter. In any situation, this is the other thing. So in the first thing I had told you about one of the key qualities of leadership is this ability to listen. To be a communicator, you have to listen. The second key thing is this ability of stepping back from oneself and getting the larger picture. Become the spectator and to see, this is what is playing out. Because as long as you are into the flow, into that particular situation, you would not be able to make out what is the best thing to do. It's only with a distance that you get a larger view, and that larger view will give you clarity of what needs to be done. Alright, so that is that. And when we talk about, so the second quality, very important quality, is this ability to become a witness consciousness. Do the step back. And this will not happen overnight. This is a systematic, sustained effort. In every situation, just instead of acting, you step back and then respond. So there is, you're familiar with this react and respond jargon, no? So it's not just for nothing. The quality that is required is this ability to, it can be in the family situation, it can be in the work situation, in all conditions. Alright. So the more one is working around that, basically what starts happening is that one starts engaging in a process of bringing in a kind of an alignment in oneself. There is a very nice Sanskrit shloka, but it goes like this. It says that manasyekam vachasyekam karmanyekam mahatma. What qualifies a great leader? They say that manasi ekam means the mind is in one thing, vachasi ekam, what the mind is thinking, the word is uttering. What the word is being uttered is the action that is being followed. If you had such a person in front of you, would you follow that person or not? We would all follow. Because we have confidence that this guy is exactly walking the talk. It's another way of saying that people who have who exhibit greatness and real leadership qualities are all those who are able to bring in this alignment of their self.
Ekagrata
is concentration. It is a particular faculty. But this is a quality of being. What we are talking of is an integrity of being. And a Swaraat is characterized by this integrity of being.
This is
And then there is exactly, it's a three correction at three levels, okay? And then the other part is, it says manasyanyat, vachasyanyat, karmanyanyat, duratmana. So people who are of not such a solid character, they will be thinking one thing, saying one thing, and doing a third thing. So the question really comes up for us is, where do we position ourselves on the spectrum? So maybe as a simplification of my former question to you, just draw the spectrum. Manasyekam is one end, vachasyekam is one end, and the other is this anyat, distraction. So just draw this line and place yourself on that spectrum. Just a fun thing. Fun thing, do that. Do that. Okay, so just do that, just for yourself. Where do you stand in terms of the integrity of your own being?
At times what happens is, person is not always what the person goes through. Person comes into a lot of other situations from their part. And then the person has to enact or probably distract whatever comes in between. Right? So for example, if I'm walking from here to there and if I have a lot of things coming in between, I would rather put it aside or jump it into water. So, there's an individual who is coming in between or the thing. Individual who is coming as a distraction, that person may think that I am not blind. Right? Because I am trying to avoid that person and just make my way ahead because my goal is somewhere else. So that alignment is from my point of view. Do I need to look at it from only from my point of view? Because then it will not mean that what I am talking, what I am saying, because at that time, maybe just distracting the person or maybe I would also say misguiding the person so that person doesn't come in my way. So then how would this alignment happen?
I'll put the question back to you. What do you think about the alignment? Where should the alignment be? Should it be a self?
Self.
How many of you think that this alignment should be a self thing?
Self.
And how many of you think that alignment needs to be a perceived alignment?
Self.
Self alignment. So there is a unanimous idea about it. Now, I assume that your question arises more from the point of view of real life situations where it becomes difficult to implement what one is wanting to do exactly, right? It comes from somewhere from that background. Now that's the whole thing. If there is a conviction that that is the right thing. Now the beauty is that, the beauty of alignment, and then I'll come on to this whole idea of the mantra. Where does the mantra fit into this whole thing? Because Kautilya talks of the mantras, right? So I'll try and bring that into the picture. Now the idea is that when a light is dispersed, when a light is like that, light is all over, when a particular source of light gives diffuse light, how powerful is it? Not very powerful. I mean, it can just give light. But when you have a laser beam, how powerful is that?
Very powerful.
Yeah.
It can completely break through. So our normal being is like this, these diffuse lights. We are just happy giving light.
Scattered.
Yeah, we're just happy giving light. That's our intention, because it's comfortable giving light. The moment one becomes like a laser, then you are creating, you are breaking, you are moving things. Because wherever the laser turns, it's going to do something major, it's going to transform. So the purpose, in a sense, if we come from this Samraat or the Swaraat to the Samraat idea, is the process of becoming from a diffuse light to a laser light. The laser light is not impacted by what is around it. The laser light impacts whatever is around it. Okay. And a real leader is like this laser light. For the simple reason that there is such clarity about where one has to go and why one is doing it. Now this could go for good things and it could go for bad things. a leader is a neutral, it's a value neutral position. What? It's a value neutral position. What one uses that leadership for is exclusively what one has to then answer to. Very simple. At the end of the day, if the conviction is that great that one can answer to whatever may come one's way, then one will follow that. But the major shift is this. Now when we come to Kautilya and he talks of these different kinds of shaktis, ma'am has spoken to you a little about them, no? That there is this utsaha shakti, there's an enthusiasm. So the leader, first and foremost, if you're absolutely convinced about something, there is enthusiasm, and just your pure enthusiasm is infectious. There is nothing more infectious than enthusiasm and happiness. If you are convinced about it, and if you are, is absolutely, anybody who's in doubt will also say, "Is bande ko to samajh mein aa raha hai." They look very confident. So what comes out of this whole the negative, the side thing, the positive side of it is, the more there is alignment, there is confidence. So Swaraat, becoming a Swaraat, the side effect, the natural side effect of becoming a Swaraat is confidence. The greater the clarity, the greater the strength and conviction of what you're doing. And this whole thing of introversion that you spoke about, if you think about it further, it is also because of fear of how the image will be perceived. Am I right in that? If you push it further, would you agree with that? How to deliver? What is stopping you from delivering? If you have the knowledge, you know where you have to go, then where can the obstacle be? What is coming in the way? Like if you know that you have to go from point A to point B, yes. You know that, yes. Then you can walk there. There has to be something else that is coming into the picture.
Yeah. I mean, what is it? Among this, whatever is written.
What do you recognize in yourself? अच्छा मैंने किसको किसका डाउट रहेगा तो
अच्छा
तो पहले ये डाउट आपके मन में रहा होगा कभी भी हाँ कोई कॉन्फिडेंस में ही आ जाता है बट इट्स कभी भी आपके मन में वो डाउट अगर था और आपको उसका आपने सॉल्यूशन आपने पा लिया है तो आप दूसरों के डाउट का सॉल्यूशन पाने में आप मदद कर पाएंगे सो अगेन एंड अगेन द लूप नो मैटर वेयर यू स्टार्ट्स एंड्स विद दिस थिंग ऑफ इफ यू हैव वर्कड इट आउट फॉर योरसेल्फ यू कैन वर्क इट आउट फॉर एनीबडी सो द इंडियन लीडरशिप मॉडल रियली स्टार्ट्स एंड एंड्स विद सेल्फ It is the most practical and the only way to begin if you want to do a shortcut to successful leadership. This is the key to shortcut, it's a shortcut key to successful leadership if you make the starting point yourself. Otherwise you'll go around, ghoom ghoom ke, is pa hi aane ka finally. So the best place to start is here. Haan, batai.
Swaraat also implies integrity.
Bilkul, na? Because the more clarity you have,
walking the talk.
It's the whole walk the talk business. The more clarity you have, the more you are ruler of yourself. So, for example, when do we say that we are master of a circumstance? Just if we're in IIT, there was one of the students who raised an interesting point. There was a talk on Krishnamurti's philosophy. Somebody had come, very good speaker. So he was talking on the science and spirituality business and all. And then he said that, look for truth, the self-enquiry. But Krishnamurti is known, Jiru Krishnamurti is known for encouraging people to engage in the process of self-enquiry. He said, leave the baggages behind in this inquiry point. So the student said, but you know, why should I spend so much time on trying to find the truth? What's the point? So like, if jaise chal raha, achha hi chal raha hai, why should I, you know, invest? It's a lot of, it's hard work. Search for understanding oneself is hard work. It's not easy thing. So why should I do that? So then one of the answers that I said is, I said it's like, we are all on the journey. ठीक है जर्नी में है और हम एक प्रोग्राम गाड़ी में बैठे हैं नाउ इफ एज अ ड्राइवर यू डोंट नो व्हाट द ऑटोमेटिक प्रोग्रामिंग ऑफ द गाड़ी इज देन वी टोटली एट द मर्सी ऑफ वेयर वी आर हेडेड सो वी आर ऑल कमिंग टू दिस वर्ल्ड लाइफ प्रोजेक्ट एंड वी आर क्लूलेस अबाउट द प्रोग्रामिंग दैट इज ड्राइविंग द गाड़ी एज अ ड्राइवर वी डोंट नो हाँ द मोर क्लैरिटी वी गेट अबाउट द प्रोग्रामिंग The more we start taking control of the steering and we can go in whichever direction we want to take the gari. And most often that direction you would take it is for our own safety. It's a very selfish self-investment. Because we don't know what programming, where it is headed, you might be headed for the cliff. And if you're a leader, then you've got the whole pattern headed for the cliff. Right? So understanding what is the programming and then choosing to reprogram it in a manner that is helpful and desirable for oneself is the basic requirement of effective driving.
How do we manage the speed of this? In that time what happens is you lose or leave the target because the frustration is I'm not reaching it, taking too long on that part. Because the clear is what you're doing on that part. That time factor which you're in the future is then becoming this issue at that time. Leave the particular goal and then really find somebody else or maybe circumstances or whatever. Find another target.
Is there anybody who would like to respond to that?
Yeah.
From your experiential wisdom, how would you address a question like that?
I think if you have made it to your life goal, then you should not give it up. If you are convinced, if you really done a self-search and realized that, okay, this is my life goal, then there is no way you should get distracted. Keep on following.
First and foremost, so if that is your burning passion in life, if that is your burning desire, like you feel that wo nahi hua to zindagi bekar hai.
So does that mean
meri zindagi
bekar hai? Does that mean should be a do or die?
Yes.
How many things do we do or die?
I don't think that you have to go to the extreme saying do or die. There may be alterations, but giving up is not the possibility. You know, you may modify it, you may relook at it, you may reform it, you may revisit it, you may think about it, and you may go on extending your horizon, but giving it up is not really the point in leadership. And that is what, you know, we always think of the situation where we think of extremes. But why should we think of extremes when there is a midway available? And that midway is very, very important. And it's again the same point she is trying to draw us, that it's the unity between you and me. I get the inspiration for leadership and I try to connect it with the group, not in a very personalized way. You know, I try to expand my horizon when I know myself. Now you try to connect it with you again, Samkhya and Yoga of Kautilya. How knowing oneself through yoga will be important for leadership role, where there will not be giving up things. But there will be modification. There will be, now enlightenment doesn't occur in this spur of the moment. And there may be again and again examination going on within ourselves. And this is the domain of knowledge. And then we decide about the domain of wisdom. And then maybe one fine morning we may experience that. But that experiential part also we don't have to conclude that this is the end. So far as we are alive and so far as we are experiencing, we may add to it, modify it, and then expand it. This may happen in our leadership role in the domain in which we are working. You know, as a leader, group leader in a particular, say, corporate sector, or our own business, company, or even our own family. Our leadership in the family, say when we just married, and our leadership in the family when 10 years after marriage, 20 years after marriage, 25 years after marriage, and we were not the same. But that evolving is there. We had never given it up. All that we wanted is a very happy family. But the content of happiness might have changed. So Swaraat actually means that what we think about the content of our goal. And you may think in that direction. It's difficult, no doubt about it. It's painful also. Because we ask questions to ourselves.
I would just like maybe just to break, because you've been sitting for 1.5 hours, then the brain also can, they have found that the brain can only take that many bites sitting in one time, you know.
I'm just saying,
so maybe if somebody of you want to take on, do one activity that you think will waken up everybody, anything, any of you can choose to just now do an activity that you think will, yes.
Can I come back?
Except for going out,
So we are going to divide this group into two parts, okay? This line will be one group. I'm okay with, you don't have to move around. And this line will be, anyone who is sitting on this line.
Virtual
division. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, if I point my hand to this side, you guys are going to clap. Okay? If I point my hand this side, you guys are going to clap. Can we do a demo?
Yes.
And you have to clap only once and in unison. Okay, you cannot keep on clapping, only in unison you have to clap. So this side of the row is one group, team A, this is team B. Okay? So let's do a demo.
Yes.
In unison, one clap. Okay, we'll do a demo. You have to clap in single unison, one single clap, all of you together. Okay. Again, we'll do it again. No, still I fear, I could hear that it's not in unison. We'll do it every year.
Yay!
You
guys
They're good leaders. Okay, so we'll do one more demo for you. Okay, let's start the game. Keep a record? Can you keep a record? Who is winning? We do just 5 or 6 and we'll decide the prize. We cannot take more time.
We can't take more time.
No, still. No, they are not in this. We'll close it.
Thank you. Okay. This is it.
Huh?
Okay, so now we can start the 2 hours all over again. Now listen. So, what I'm saying is that we have now understood that for this Swaraat thing, we are moving in that direction. So there is a direction to everything. Now if we have to take this whole movement business right to the start, where does the first movements begin in existence? Self-realization is a goal, but I'm saying if you have to collapse the universe into the first movement, what is the very first movement in creation?
Thought
even earlier than that?
Desire,
even earlier than human beings were there. What are the first movements in the universe?
Life,
even before that? What comes even before life?
Big bang.
Okay, yes, so what is, let me ask you that.
Vacuum.
What is, is there a vacuum? That's a big question in itself. But what is there? Okay, next to vacuum, what is there?
Atoms.
And then what is the movement?
Gravity.
Cell.
Cell air, yes.
Molecular energy.
Molecular energy, yeah. So everything ultimately boils down to energy, right? So that's where movement really starts. There is energy at the basis. I'm trying to connect it to what we are doing. So if there is movement right at the start, there is these vibrations that are there. When you look at a human being, what are the different levels of vibrations that come together to form the individual? What are the different levels of vibrations that we are made of? Physical? So that's the most dense. It's the same vibration. There's nothing other than energy. Alright, that energy in different densities forms different parts of who we are. So when it's most dense, it is our body. The next level of density? What are we made of? What are the other aspects of our being?
Thought
before, also another more dense than thought maybe?
Organs,
yes, so that's the body. Everything comes into the body. So we've covered the body. The next is, let's say, the emotional.
The mind.
The emotional level is quite thick in terms of its vibrations compared to the mind. So because it has a little more, it has a heart, it has a thought, there are so many things, okay? Also directly related to our digestive systems, you know, so many things are quite closely. So almost like the rest. So you have the emotional. So there's the physical, there's the emotional, then there is the, when that gets more rarefied, it becomes the thoughts. And then even more rare than that is more the energy, the self or the spirit part. Okay, so all these parts, so now just imagine yourself as a being that is vibrating at all these levels. The whole body. So don't think of yourself as these solid concrete beings. This is an exercise in dissolving yourself into energy. Okay? So just imagine that you are at your physical level, you're vibrating. At an emotional level, you're vibrating beings. Mental level. Now if you had to describe the interaction of all these vibrations, how would you describe it? Is it something in harmony or is it like a lot of noise? Is it in harmony? So the emotions and the mind. Okay, let me draw it out for you. So if I'll just do it here to follow. Okay, so that's a vibration, let's say. Do you think that all your vibrations are allowing like that?
No.
No.
Right light is there.
Swaraat manifested. आपको पहले बोलना था ना? I've spent a whole hour and a half for that. Okay, so. Generally, for the rest of us, we are all with that. Even that, I mean, how much do we really know? How much are you aware of your breathing? Right? The machine is apparently in harmony, that's why it is moving, it is holding together and moving. But that is an apparent harmony. But one point it suddenly breaks down. That breakdown can't happen if everything was going harmoniously all the time. That breakdown happens because there were things, parts that were loose and all, and we didn't pay attention, and suddenly the whole gaadi comes to a halt. Right? So again, to ensure that we have harmony in the body level, Swaraat is key. We are so clueless. Like I said, the breathing is the first place to start. We're so clueless about where the breath is moving, how it is moving. And that is only one part. We can choose to breathe, we can choose to stop breathing. We cannot guarantee we'll take the next breath. So there is a relationship with another energy at work that is ensuring that we keep breathing. And what? Okay, so just coming down to this vibration part of it. So we have basically seen that we are in this confused noise existence in terms of the vibratory parts. Now, when Chanakya talked of three kinds of Shakti as a leadership, the first one was his Utsaha, so that conviction that comes of a mental and emotional alignment of oneself. The second one was Prabhava Shakti. So once there is this alignment, like I said, with the laser light, wherever it turns, it will do a Prabhava there. It will transform. The third one he talks about is the mantra shakti. So we are trying to come on to this mantra shakti. What did you, let me ask you just quickly, because we are now, time is tightening up. So what do we understand by mantra shakti? What would you understand there?
Affirmations.
Chanting, alright.
Affirmations,
yes.
Positive thoughts,
okay. So now coming back to the traditional source of what a mantra is. If the whole universe is full of vibrations, we also know that a specific vibration corresponds to a specific effect. So if I make one vibration, I will break glass. I change the vibration, I no longer
resonance.
Break glass.
Resonance.
Not just resonance, every vibration corresponds to one-to-one effect
in
the physical world. This effect also goes into our different levels. So if I listen to one music, I feel happy. If I listen to another music, I feel sad. If I listen to one music, I have certain thoughts. If I listen to another music, I have another kind of thoughts.
Yes.
So vibration is touching us at a single sound frequency. It's touching us at a physical level. It is touching us at an emotional level. It is touching us at a mental level. So every sound corresponds to a definite effect. Huh? Now, when a mantra is nothing more, but I would say the technical definition of a mantra is systematized sound technology. Sounds have been consciously and spontaneously been arranged in a manner that they will necessarily give you the desired effect. That is a mantra. Very technically, if you go through the definition of a mantra, it is mananat trayate, which means once you keep thinking about that thing, it will protect you. It will deliver you, it will free you. Now if you understand, if you look at this as being a mess, how can you ensure that this messy system starts becoming a streamlined system? What would you do to this?
Focus on meditation.
Exactly. So what you would do is to bring in a conscious vibration into that and start focusing all the other vibrations around it. So if there is a clarity of purpose, clarity of goal, your emotions will then, if that is what is your lifeline, Swami Vivekananda said that, no? He said, think of one thing and make that your life mission and you are sure to succeed. That's the only way of living life, no? So I mean, I've paraphrased it very poorly compared to his words, but you get the gist of it. So the thing is that the moment there is, you bring in one strong vibration. Traditionally, these were established sounds. Again, in all cultures, they have had sounds that give them strength, that give fearlessness. So if you chant something at a certain point, you feel fearless. Because that particular vibration is restructuring your vibratory patterns to follow a desired result. A mantra would do that. That it would restructure our mind, our thing. So whether you understand it or not, a mantra is already restructuring your system. Is restructuring the sound structure of your system. And mantras, the ones that have been consciously, spontaneously conceived, they are meant to align us to the larger cosmic vibrations. It is not just about me and myself, but if me and myself is not related to what is outside, because we are vibrations. So I am influencing you just by my very presence. You are influencing us by just being who you are, the way you are. Because you have a sum total of vibrations. So just the very fact, like they would say, the Buddha was so aligned that when he came into a space, he impacted 2 kilometer radius of that space. That was the power of his alignment. So that is the Samraat. Samraat means the ruler of the world, where you don't have to do anything, you just have to be. The modern definitions of management and, you know, leadership is very often about having things, having. In fact, the whole education system that we have grown into is a system that teaches us to have.
Acquire.
It's all about having. But if you understand that having only adds to your net thing, there is a net quantity on which you can add. But just like you can add, you can detract that also. But the net thing will remain the net thing. The entire focus of the Indian tradition was on being. It was on the focus of that net content. What is the power of that net content, and how can that, how can a rearrangement of that net content make it the most effective net content around? So that is the whole Swaraat business. This focus on the net content. And very interestingly, again, just a valuable thing. In Marathi, do you have a verb to have? In Marathi or your mother tongue, do you have a verb to have? What is the verb to have? If you say, I have a book, how will you say?
You want.
No, how do you say, I have a book?
Pustak paije.
I doesn't mean is or have.
I
is
is.
Paije.
Paije is to get. But I'm saying to have.
There is no word.
So what it comes also, like I discovered this in the Sanskrit language, it doesn't have a verb to have. Can you imagine the entire Indian culture? We don't have words to have. Things are with us. But you cannot have a thing. It's a huge, I mean, if you think of it, it is mind-blowing that a civilization has evolved over thousands of years and it has not conceived of the activity or the experience of having. Because the idea is that everything is. That thing, it is with me, but it is. I am not. When you say I have, this doesn't have any value. It is dead thing. But if you think this is with me, this is also as important as I am. It can be with me, it can go also. But if you can just, I would say in your free time, just contemplate on what it implies. To have a civilization that has not thought of having, but only of being. And the value of the value and importance of being. Everything was on who you are and not what you have. Never. Because at the end of the day, when Yamaraj is at the doorstep, what you have will be of zero value. It is only who you are that will make, that would have left any impact on whoever you have connected with in your lifetime. So it is only when one has this, one makes this focus the most important focus of one's existence, that then you don't have to even worry about leadership. It will be a natural birthright. You just, I mean, that's, it's not that I'm saying this. This is like all great people of all civilizations. It's not even a monopoly of the Indian civilization as such. Any individual who has investigated about the intrinsic value of our life has arrived at this conclusion. Invest time in yourself, invest time in building an alignment. The moment the alignment is achieved, everything else will fall in line. And why will everything else fall in line? Again, it's all, I would say it's very scientific. This whole mantra business and why mantra shakti is so valuable is very scientific. If I am, let's say you said positive thinking, no, with mantra and all. Now if I am, a thought is a vibration, right? Now if I'm sending out a particular positive thought, how does it impact the environment around me? What can you say about the vibrations? How will the vibrations around me change? How will it, or rather, what will it amplify around me? So all the frequencies of that nature will be amplified. Very simple. Very simple fundamental energy level working. That if I'm sending out a particular vibration, every vibration of that quality will be enhanced, amplified. If I'm always thinking negative things, what am I amplifying around me? And that is what is going to come into my life. So you could have heard of this law of attraction and, you know, secret laws. It's basically this funda. That what you are emitting is what is coming in. To what extent it comes in depends on how strong your vibration is. So we also hear people who say, you know, I really want that, but it's not happening. Now again, if you examine yourself, you will see that while I am thinking that that is what I really want, andar mein wo dar hai ki agar nahi hua, nahi hua, nahi hua. And that is the more powerful vibration that the universe is listening to. So you're sending a mixed message. And whichever is the stronger one, whichever is closer to your gut, is what is going to be realized. Okay? So a mantra, when we talk of it in terms of sounds, with combinations of words, it is when we have, when you're creating a positive vibration, when you understand a mantra, then the mind vibrations are following it. When you mean what you are saying, then your actions are also accompanying it. Then I can tell you, I mean, the guarantee is that you will be unstoppable. And then the prayer is that you should be unstoppable for the right reasons. For the greater good of the world. Okay, because ultimately, negative, because it is also interrelated, there is no vibration that we would put out there that would not hit us back at some point. So for very selfish reasons again, the more positive the vibration is, the more positive the feedback and return and growth. Okay, so I would, I'm coming to the end of my time. I would just like to probably conclude with one mantra, which is always chanted when you, when there is collective activity that takes place. And again, this particular mantra also gives us an insight into collective functioning. So some of you might be familiar, but I will say it so that you know you can repeat after me. So the mantra is Sahana Bhavatu.
Sahana Bhavatu.
Sahanau Bhunaktu.
Sahanau Bhunaktu.
Sahaviryam.
Sahaviryam.
Karavavahai.
Karavavahai.
Tejasvi.
Tejasvi.
Nava.
Nava.
Dhitamastu.
Dhitamastu.
Ma Vidvishavahai.
Ma Vidvishavahai.
This is what we would call a secular mantra, but when I say secular, it has no religious component to it, because it says Sahana Bhavatu, protect us together. So when we have come together, first and foremost, this doesn't happen by chance. There are forces of the universe that are making things move. So we have been brought together. So the first important condition for collective working is a protected environment. You can try your best if, let's say, we suddenly decide to have this class in Antarctica and you're not dressed in the right way. Nobody will even think straight, because it'll be too cold to think. It'll be too cold to do anything. So if you want to ensure a good collective working atmosphere, one has to ensure good collective working spaces. Protected space. Sahana Bhavatu. Protect us together. Sahana Bhunaktu. You can have a protected environment, but if everybody's fighting, minds are all like, nothing much is going to come out of this collective working. So let us nourish us together. Psychologically, let there be nourishment happening. Saha Viryam Karavavahai. Together, let us do something with courage. If you are coming here and doing the same old thing again and again, then it's a waste of time. You will not come to the same thing if I had to repeat this 10 times again. Nobody is going to come. So let's do something new together. But what should be the... let's do this with courage. How should it be? How should it be? Tejasvinava Dhitamastu. Whatever we are putting our collective energies, let it be brilliant. Let it bring light. Let it be something that, you know, that will bring light to things. And finally, Ma Vidvishavahai. Let us not quarrel. But it comes from this word Dvesha, which means animosity or, you know. So it doesn't say let us not have difference of opinion. That is not what is being said. Difference of opinion is valuable to have more enriching collective gathering. But Dvesha means not working together in terms of compatibility of thought. So if we have come together, it's for a common goal. But if we have personal animosity, we will forget the personal goal and just sit here and waste our time discussing our personal thing. That's the whole ego business. So Ma Vidvishavahai means let us not have these two goals in a common project. Have a common goal. So as a leader, this particular mantra is very simple, but one, in terms of sounds, it helps to create that ambience because of, it's a mantra, so as a sound it will help to generate it. But most importantly, it gives you a spectrum of what is the environment in which you can have maximum efficient working, collective working, safe environment, nourishment of the individual being, courage to, so you need to, and you need to inspire the team to have courage, not to be afraid. So if somebody is saying something, are kya bol rahe ho, that's correct. You never get that kind. So encourage people to see what they want to, because then only you will also be, you will understand what's going on and you can encourage that growth. Let it be brilliant, let it add something to you. And finally, let there not be two projects in a common project. Ensure that the common goals are set, and whatever the discussion, make sure that it leads back to that common goal. If it is a discussion that is leading away from it, then that is not the space to have that discussion. But for that, one as a leader has to have the clarity of where one is going together and how to manage emerging discussions to redirect it to that common goal.
Okay.
So just to close, I would like to just chant it. I request you to chant after me. And we can end with Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. This, when in the mantras you do this Om Shanti, 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 it's really about saying that we have spent time together, we put in a lot of vibrations into the atmosphere. Now let it all come to let all those vibrations quieten down. Only then will something new emerge. You know the famous Zen story of a student went to a teacher and said, please teach me, I've come to learn from you. So the teacher looked at him and asked his other disciple to bring him a cup and a jug full of tea. So he sat down there and this teacher kept the glass in front of him, the cup in front of him, and started pouring the tea. And he poured and poured and the tea overflowed and this fellow kept pouring. So after a time the teacher said, the student said, sir, what are you doing? Stop, stop. So he's saying, if you come like a full cup, where can I pour anything? So very often we enter spaces full already. And then it becomes very difficult to receive. So it's very valuable to be in a spirit of emptiness, add our experiences, but be in the most receptive spirit. Alright. So if you don't mind, we'll just chant this once, you repeat after me, and we'll just end on this end the okay, I might take one minute already. Come. Sahana Bhavatu.
Sorry? Can you say something in Italian?
Exactly.
I thought you were saying.
italiano è una lingua molto bella, molto musica, da molto felice. And that's why you see, the sounds of a language also convey a spirit. So it's full of these vowels and all, and that's why the whole body starts moving. You know, you can't speak Italian like that. Non posso parlare italiano come sa. No, c'è molto musica, il cuore è aperto. Molto piacere conoscervi. Very happy to know you.
Grazie. Okay, just a small thanksgiving from all outside to you. So first of all, it's been a pleasure you having here, and we would want you to be coming again. That's our first sincere. Second, I think it was one of the most innovative way of, you know, explaining leadership and spirituality, because we could see a lot of your actions, a lot of your expressions. I think as a leader, convincing not only from your mind but also from the way you gesture and express, I think is one of the most beautifully done class, and we are really thankful to you for this most spiritedly enthusiastic lecture, and it's a really wonderful to have you, and most of the concepts theoretically explained by our teachers were here, and dramatically and expressly done by you, I think it's like coming together. As a student, we couldn't have expected more than this. Thank you so much.